Finals presented by Capital One. This is game six here in this Lexington Regional. We have reached the finals. The number one seed Kentucky takes on the three seed Indiana. Indiana will be home. If they win, they move on to the Supers. If Kentucky wins, we play a winner take all tomorrow. Let's take a look at our bracket here in this Lexington Regional. On the bottom, earlier today was the elimination game between the one seed and the two seed. West Virginia was eliminated with a 10-0 win for Kentucky. Kentucky moves on. We have a rematch to last night's game. It was a thriller. What's up, everybody? Alongside my partner, he's former LSU star and big leaguer, Todd Walker. I'm John Schifrin. Todd, before we even had any play here in this Lexington Regional, you looked at the matchups. You said it was wide open. But to give you an idea just how what a big accomplishment Indiana has done so far. There's only two national number three seeds who are 2-0, Texas Tech and Indiana.
Well, the youngest team in the Big Ten, Jeff Mercer, will tell you at 43 wins, they're overachieving this year, but they are 2-0 in this bracket. This game was close last night between Kentucky and Indiana. Kentucky had a 3-1 lead going into the seventh, and then this happened.
If you missed it, let's get you caught up. Last night, bottom of the seventh, Kentucky up 3-1. Peter Cerruto did this.
Out of the 9-hole, Peter Cerruto had an 0-2 count, worked it to full. The three-run homer in the seventh inning puts Indiana in the lead 4-3. They tack another on. Four runs in the seventh and eighth for Indiana to win that game against Kentucky.
It was a thriller. Let's focus on the starting pitchers tonight. For Kentucky, getting the ball with the righty, Logan Martin.
Yeah, the Swanee transfer, the fourth-year senior, 6'1", 185 from Cartersville, Georgia. Had a non-throwing injury, trying to work back off of that. Let's see how that'll affect him. He's been throwing on Friday nights for Kentucky, and his last start was April 22nd, where he only went two innings against A&M.
So he hasn't had much work. In a similar situation is Ben Seiler, the lefty, getting the ball for Indiana.
Big boy, though, 6'6", 245 left-hander, is getting his eighth start. He's a fifth-year senior. Only one outing of five innings. That was back in February. Over his last month, the most he's thrown in a game is three innings. He's the opener, so you can expect him to go one time through the lineup before they make a move.
Kentucky fans have packed Kentucky Proud Park. The Wildcats, they need to win to stay alive. If Indiana wins, they move on to the Supers. First pitch in this Lexington Regional Final is coming up next. Take a look at the starting lineup for the Kentucky Wildcats. And earlier today against West Virginia, the bats exploded. 10 runs. Todd, that was the first time since May the 18th.
And they'd scuffled the first two games of this regional to score runs. They had the best batting average within the 30-game schedule of the SEC this year at 282. But they got to get this guy going. Jackson Gray, 0-for-11 in this tournament.
Starting pitcher for Indiana, the lefty, Ben Seiler. 6'6", 245.
Yeah, big boy. But again, I think they're labeling him as an opener in this game. Whether or not he can last even one time through the lineup, the most he's thrown in a game over the last month has been three innings. But that's not necessarily a bad thing. They created that because as a hitter, it becomes your advantage the more you face a pitcher. And so they'll just have to get one look at him.
How about that? Breaking ball, first pitch, gets the swing and the miss on Jackson Gray. Greg Harmon will be our home plate umpire tonight. Said that one's low and outside for ball one. 1-1 the count. Ben Seiler's got a little deceptiveness to his delivery. You see, when he pulls the ball out of his glove, he kind of cups his wrist and hides the ball when he brings it to the plate.
Yeah, in addition to just hiding it behind his body. And this is what Jackson Gray does. Even though he hadn't had a hit in this tournament, he works counts. He's a good leadoff hitter, can handle the bat. Doesn't strike out a whole lot.
2-2 pitch. Breaking ball fought off by Gray. Gray didn't get a hit early today, but he did score twice. Hit by a pitch and scored in the first and walked and scored in the eighth. So he has been getting on base for Kentucky, and he's run the count to full. Ball 4 low.
Just a great at bat from Jackson Gray. Fights off a couple pitches, and on a 3-2 count, there was a strike for about 40 feet to home plate. Drops out of the zone, and good job of letting it travel, seeing it all the way through. Leadoff walk for Kentucky.
So the walk for a walk for the leadoff hitter. Gotta bring up Jace Felker. Shows bunt, pulls it back, but it was a strike called. Felker here in this regional, 4-for-11. Saw plenty of that in the game earlier against West Virginia. 5 batters got hit for Kentucky, and Felker gets a free pass.
This is not a good sign if you're Jeff Mercer and Dustin Glantz, pitch coach for Indiana. A walk and a hit by pitch to start this regional final. And they haven't even hit the 3-4-5 hitters yet for the Cats.
Todd, how did Kentucky do it? That's the 13th batter hit by a pitch by Kentucky here in this regional. Devin Burke steps in. First pitch stays upstairs for ball one.
Yeah, I think it's 122 hit by pitches for Kentucky. That's top 5 in the country.
Seiler got to figure out a way to calm down and figure out his control here. Because Kentucky, they'll jump on you early. And here's Peter Cerruto, who wants to talk to his pitcher.
Yeah, for both sides, even with Logan Martin on the other side, who we haven't seen yet. They haven't had a whole lot of outings over the last month, so it clearly is going to take some time to settle in. And unfortunately for both these teams, they don't have a lot of time. And if you start giving away free passes to how good Indiana and Kentucky is, it's going to be tough to stay in this game. And more than the walks and the hit by pitches, it's putting hitters in hitters counts, and as each ball goes by, it makes each hitter more confident.
Well, the stadium playing Baby Shark is certainly not going to calm his nerves, I'll tell you that much. Two and oh the count on the catcher Burks. Seiler. It's like a changeup for strike one.
As much as you'd want to go after this,
pitcher struggling.
Yeah, I'm taking. I already knew what you were going to ask. I got to take this pitch.
Drives it deep out to left. Jesse giving chase. And it is a foul ball.
Now, the reason I say that, John, is because the 3-2 is going to be the same pitch. So if you take 3-1 and it's a strike, and then you're going to get the same pitch 3-2. But at least you give the pitcher a chance to self-implode if he's going to do it.
Man, Burks was ready. He jumped all over that 3-1. Count is now full. Nobody out. Runners on at first and second. Runners go. Hit and run was on. Up the middle. Stepping on the bag at second over to first. A double play turn. That's Evan Goforth getting the start at second base in place of Tyler Cerny, who was ejected from last night's game for bringing out a celebration chain onto the field.
And they led Goforth all the way to the bag. On the steal, he's covering the bag, so he runs up the middle, and that's where the ball's hit right there. Nice job by Goforth to take it by himself, and the double play. Huge play for Indiana, because, again, Seiler was scuffling.
Emilian Petre lifts it out to center, and Ben Seiler works himself out of the jam. Kentucky strands a runner at third, And Indiana, they will race into the dugout because it is scoreless. Hoosiers bats coming up. Here's the lineup for the Indiana Hoosiers, and we're going to highlight the leadoff hitter, Philip Glasser. He jumped on the starter, Zach Lee. First pitch took him deep to center field last night.
So watch what he gets here. First pitch curveball for Philip Glasser. Logan Martin hasn't been out there a whole lot over the last month. We talked about it, the non-throwing injury. He was Kentucky's opening starter on SEC weekends. Not necessarily their ace, but he's done a nice job for him. He's got a big arm, power arm in the mid-90s with a plus slider.
So there's Martin you're talking about. Martin gets the start, the senior, the righty. They want him to eat up some innings for Kentucky. They need to stay alive. This is a must-win game for the Wildcats.
Yeah, let's see if he can rebound from that injury. Again, it was a non-throwing injury, and he's a dude. I mean, he can really bring it with that power arm at about 96, 97. But watch this
first
pitch
curveball.
All right,
so you think first pitch wrinkle here to Glasser?
Yeah, that's my bet.
Martin does go with the off-speed breaking ball for strike one.
1-0, John. I got you.
Tip my hat to you. You called it. Fastball away, 96 miles per hour. Martin's got some life on that fastball. Glasser hitting over 350. Seven home runs. Swings through that fastball, 1-2. Here in this regional, Glasser's 3-for-8. Two got him swinging. What a pitch by Martin to start the game for Kentucky.
And if you wanted to draw up of how to attack an at bat, that's it. First pitch curveball for a strike, lands the curveball, hasn't seen the changeup yet, and just drops it out of the zone for strike three. Nice job for Logan Martin to start this game.
Brings up the center fielder, Bobby Whalen. Whalen, the junior from Camp Hill, Pennsylvania. Whalen had a tough night last night, went 0-for-4 with 3 strikeouts against Kentucky. Looking for the bounce back here today. 2-1 pitch. Man, that fastball, it gets in on you quick.
Yeah, it's got some giddy up behind it. I mean, he really can pitch. I mean, they trusted him enough to throw the openers at these SEC weekends, and that's saying a lot.
Did he go? No, he did not, says first base umpire Tim Rosso.
But what else do you expect from a Kentucky's pitcher in this tournament, right, John? I mean, with the Travis Smith and Mason Moore and Zach Lee and the outings they've had from their guys on the bump this weekend.
3-2, breaking ball, fought off by Whalen, gets into the seats.
Two shutouts, complete shutouts by Kentucky in 3 games. That's pretty strong.
First time in NCAA tournament history for Kentucky. Fastball, wow, was he late on that one.
And that's why that netting's up right there. That could have hurt somebody.
Kentucky fans start the slow clap. They want the strikeout on the 3-2. He did go around. Back-to-back strikeouts for Logan Martin to start this first.
You see the awkward swing so far by Indiana. They can really swing the bat, especially their first two guys with Glasser and Whalen. But it shows you how dominant that slider and that changeup is from Logan Martin to go along with that 95, 96 mile an hour heater.
Brings up the Big Ten Freshman of the Year, Devin Taylor. Good. Really good. You know, it's so interesting the different approaches you can have on the same pitching staff. Zach Lee was so calm, so smooth on the mound last night. Logan Martin, you can tell he's a fiery guy. He's animated. He likes to get after it. Both effective.
And you wonder, but the difference is it's high energy too, right? So you wonder how long that lasts. I mean, it's hard to keep that up for an extended period of time.
2-0, Taylor fouls it off. You can also understand the excitement. Getting the ball to start here in this regional final at home. Oh, did it hit him? No, it didn't. 3-1.
With your season on the line. You know, again, if Indiana loses, they've got another game. But if Kentucky loses, they're out.
Stays upstairs. Ball four to Taylor. Brings up the cleanup hitter, first baseman Brock Tibbetts. Tibbetts hitting 366 on the season. Breaking ball stays outside. It's now 2-0. Taylor takes his lead at first. Fastball up and a called strike. Strike one. Two down here in this bottom of the first. We have not seen an Indiana hitter get on top of that high fastball from Logan Martin yet.
And it's almost impossible to do that with any kind of velocity behind it. And that's a purposeful pitch. It looks good to a hitter because it's closer to your eyes, but impossible to catch up to when it's 96 miles an hour.
The 2-2 to Tibbetts. Breaking ball spoiled at the plate. Taking a lot of deep breaths. Looking for his third strikeout here in this first. The 2-2. Indiana's certainly making Martin work early. 25th pitch of the inning coming up here. Lifts this one out to right. McCarthy makes the catch, and Indiana will strand the runner at first. At the end of one, no score between Kentucky and Indiana here in Lexington. Well, when you look at the odds for Kentucky, they're in their favor right now. National one seeds, when they lose a game so far in the regional and get to the regional final, they will win the first game 65% of the time. But the second game, they actually will only win less than half the time. You got to win the first one, though. There's the first base hit of the ball game. Hunter Gillum starts this second off with a single.
That sounded a lot like my Algebra 2 class in high school right there. That's a lot of numbers going on right there. Kentucky with leadoff base hit.
Basically, that says that Kentucky's favored to win this one.
I got you. Yeah, and Vegas feels the same way. They had Ben Seiler on the ropes in the first inning, let him off the hook with the double play, and now they start off in the second with the base hit. I just feel like right now for Kentucky, if they could be a little more patient. They were patient with their first two hitters and then got out of control, but again, like I said before, when a pitcher's kind of on the ropes and, you know, he's in position to self-implode, you go ahead and let him do it. Let him throw some pitches. Let him prove to you that he's back under control.
Here's the DH, Reuben Church. And that hit him. My goodness. Third time Reuben Church has been hit in a regional. And the 14th by a Kentucky batter. That's smart, Clay. That's what I do.
Yeah. Got him on the inside, the right leg.
I mean, look at where his feet are at. He is right on the edge of that batter's box, right on top of the plate. He welcomes it.
Well, that slider has a big-time break on it. You saw that coming from over the plate into his right leg.
Bunt put down by Waldschmidt. Fielded at third. Throw to first for the out by Pine. And the left fielder for Kentucky does his job, advances the runners to second and third with one out.
That's what Kentucky does. Leads the SEC conference in bunts and steals, and even in the second inning. And even with the seven-hole hitter, with the eight-hole hitter coming up, McCarthy's already got a home run in this tournament. They leave it up to their boy to get the job done. Guy at third, less than 2 outs. I always thought these at-bats were the least difficult because all you really have to do is put the ball in play.
McCarthy swings at that first pitch. He was 2-for-4 earlier today against West Virginia. An RBI double in the second and a two-run home run in the fourth. Kentucky a 10-0 win over West Virginia to send the Mountaineers home. And Todd, to your point, it seems like Kentucky's a lot more patient. Seemed like in that first inning, they had a big threat, and then it just kind of ended quickly. One ball, one strike to the Kentucky right fielder. Big swing. He's posing. He likes it. Back at the wall. See ya. Nolan McCarthy. What a shot to left. That fan's loving it. His third home run of the season. A three-run shot for Kentucky. And the Wildcats take a 3-0 lead here in the second.
Ben Seiler's faced 8 hitters so far, struggled through most of them. We predicted he'd go through the lineup once, and it's already 3-0. Not looking good for Indiana. Kentucky gives them an out with the sack bunt, but Nolan McCarthy with a bomb to left field. 3-0 Cats.
I mean, that was just an absolute no-doubter by Nolan McCarthy. Bottom of the lineup, Grant Smith swings over the top of that one. How about the day for Nolan McCarthy? 3-for-5. He's got 2 home runs and a double. 6 RBI on the day for McCarthy. Wow.
And that's an 8-hole hitter posing on that home run. I mean, as if he does it like it's his job.
Smith sends this one back up the middle, and everyone's getting in on the party for Kentucky. Man, I gotta see that shot by McCarthy again.
Low and in, and the launch angle. I'd love to see what that angle was. Crushes it to left field and knew it right away. Wow.
Top of the lineup for the Wildcats, Jackson Gray. Walked and was stranded at third his first time up.
Yeah, you got the lefty-on-lefty matchup. Let's see how this works out. But I think if you're Indiana and he struggles to get Jackson Gray out, got to be thinking about making a move.
Kentucky managed to get 3 runs last night against Indiana in the 5-3 loss. They've already got 3 here in the second. Breaking ball stays upstairs. It is 3-0 to the Kentucky leadoff hitter, Jackson Gray. And we're starting to see some early activity in the Indiana bullpen. Instruction.
Same deal here if you're Jackson Gray. 3-1 count, three balls, only one strike. I might be tempted to take this pitch just to keep myself out of letting him off the hook by swinging at something a little out of the zone. If he throws a strike, 3-2, you're going to get the same fastball at that count as well.
Three-run breaking ball. The high strike is called. It's full. Similar situation to the first. Gray saw a full count. He would draw a walk. Let's see what he does here in the second.
Yeah, so whatever you get 3-1, you're going to get 3-2 almost all the time. And so Jackson Gray gets the slider up and in. It's called a strike. Gets the 3-2. Isn't able to put it in play. So now this pitch could be something different. I would imagine he wouldn't triple up with the slider and come back with the fastball here.
Back-to-back seven-pitch at-bats for Gray. They check on the runner at first. Siler shakes off the first. Now he's got his sign. Payoff pitch. And that hit him. Third hit batter. It's now 15 hit batters for Kentucky this regional.
And that's what they do, like we talked about, top five in the country and get hit by the pitch. And that's why, because they just don't move. You throw it in on them, they're not moving. And they just take it, get on first, and out comes Indiana to have a talk with Siler. And that's pitching coach Dustin Glant. I can't imagine you can let this game get any further out of hand. It's only one out, first and second. Siler struggled through the first time through the lineup, and generally when that happens, it's not going to get much better the second time through. They've already had a look at you. They know how to attack you, which in this case would be more patient, and make him throw three strikes in a row. Or I would say three strikes and then a bat for that matter. They're going to leave him out there.
Ben Siler has faced 10 hitters for Kentucky. He's hit three of them. Worked himself into another jam here in the second. Runners on at first and second with one out. Chase Felker. He rips this one to left. They're going to hold the runner at third. So Smith puts on the brakes at third, and now the bases are loaded.
Not counting the sack bunt where they gave themselves up. Eight of the 11 hitters have reached base against Ben Siler.
Could this be it for Ben Siler? With the bases loaded, one out here in the top of the second.
Yeah, they've already been out there once. And I think they've caught Kentucky, you know, back on the upswing. We've talked about their offense, you know, a little lull the first two games. They scored 10 runs earlier today, and you're just catching a hot offense right now.
So Indiana will make a pitching change. Ben Siler only able to go 1 1/3. He leaves with the bases loaded. One out here in this top of the second. Kentucky already with a 3-run home run in this inning. We'll be back to Lexington after this. Indiana makes the early call to the bullpen. The freshman Ethan Phillips will come on for his 15th appearance of the season.
Just another kid getting some big time experience this year. The freshman, Ethan Phillips. A lot of walks, 16 walks in only 30 innings. ERA below 5, but he hasn't lost this year yet. 28 hits, 15th appearance for Ethan Phillips, and they really need him to throw strikes here in a situation where base is loaded and really no room for error.
What has changed with this Kentucky offense? The first two games, 7 runs. Last two, 13.
Yeah, I think it's just confidence. You know, when you talk about hitting's contagious, that's a real thing.
The catcher, Devin Burke, steps in with a deep breath. For the season, with the bases loaded, he is 3-for-9.
And Ethan Phillips likes to work down in the zone. He throws that sinker slider, and if you're Burks, you've got to get the ball up because you don't want to beat it in the ground and end up getting him out of the inning.
Burks grounded into a double play to end the threat in the first.
If you're Indiana, you're looking for the swing and miss. And how are you going to get it? The slider on the outside corner will work, and a fastball above the belt.
Good stop by Peter Cerruto. That saved a run right there.
Saved a run. Great job. You're right, by Cerruto. That turf's tough. We've seen a lot of balls bounce away from catchers because it just gains momentum when it hits the ground. Cerruto saves a run, and that's not a pitch that Burks generally swings at. So it's going to have to be that slider on the outside corner that looks like a strike. Or, again, the elevated fastball.
1-2. Did he go? Home plate umpire Greg Harmon says yes. So Phillips comes in. He gets the strikeout of Burks, and there's now 2 down.
It's nasty. See if he went around. He sure did.
Ninth hitter for Kentucky to come to the plate this inning, Emilian Petre. And that one gets past the catcher, Cerruto. Coming in to score is Smith. Kentucky with a 4-0 lead here in the second. It's ruled a wild pitch from Phillips.
Just giving a really good team too many free passes. I mean, the hit by pitches, there's been 2 of those, 3 of them. The walks, and now pass ball, and you know, we're only in the second inning, but Kentucky's too good. You got to make them earn it.
How about the end of this? Grant Smith, the shortstop, after sliding a little gimpy when he popped up on that slide going into the dugout. Let's check to see if he's okay. They need him at short.
Yeah, with the lead they've got, you've got to have your defense in. Grant Smith's only made 3 errors all year. He's one of the better consistent shortstops in the league.
Two balls and a strike. The count to Petre, the second baseman. Way outside, 3-1.
This is a situation where you don't have to just split the plate on Petre. You got first base open, 2 outs, the lefty on righty matchup. So this is a deal where you try to get him to swing and miss. If you walk him, that's okay. Fights the right-hander, Gillum on deck.
Fastball, perfect location. It's full. And he lost him. With first base open, Petre draws the walk. It's loaded again.
And the 10th hitter coming to the plate in this second inning, Hunter Gillum, the five spot, had a base hit his last time up. See it sliding in from Grant Smith.
Ooh. Looked like he landed right there. Left ankle.
I think he's fine. I think it's just like a temporary deal. Zinged him a little bit.
Bases loaded, two outs. Hunter Gillum, who started off this single with a single and come around to score, will come up to the plate.
Yeah, Kentucky likes to do this. They huddle up instead of just giving signs of bunts or whatever. Coach Mangione likes to get their opinion on certain things. He's taught them well, and they know the game, but I don't quite know what that would be about. There's two outs, bases loaded. There's nothing really to do but hit.
So Gillum, his second at bat in this inning. Different pitcher. That one gets past the catcher, Cerruto, but the runners stay put. Ball one.
Ball's moving all over the place for Ethan Phillips, who's primarily the sinker slider guy. And we see, yeah, it was his ankle.
It was his right ankle, and you can see it's now taped up over his cleat.
But it shows how dirty some of these pitches are from Ethan Phillips. I mean, Cerruto, as good of a catcher as he is, having a tough time handling a lot of these pitches. It's moving all over the place.
Turn. 2-0, putting play to left side, right at the shortstop. Glasser gets the lead runner at second. So Kentucky leads, the bases loaded, but they score four in the inning. The big shot, a three-run home run by Nolan McCarthy.
Second of the day from Nolan McCarthy. Four runs for the Cats as we go to the bottom of the second.
See Grant Smith after that pop-up slide scoring. He's got his right ankle taped up. He is back in the field at short for Kentucky as Indiana comes to the plate here in this bottom of the second. John Schriffen, Todd Walker on the call. Logan Martin, the starter, back for his second inning of work. He threw 25 pitches in that first inning. 5-6-7 at the plate for the Hoosiers. Matheson swings at this first pitch. A drive out to right field on the warning track is McCarthy. He makes the catch.
Just under it for Carter Matheson. And it shows you how much the ball is carrying in this ballpark. He got straight up under it, and it gets all the way back to the track.
So Martin had to work hard in that first inning, but he's got one pitch, one out here in the second. Third baseman Josh Pine.
That would be my approach against Logan Martin. If you see, you know, a high-intensity pitcher, make him throw some pitches. You know, you get him out of the game a little earlier. And he was very effective in the first inning. And equal, also, you're down by four. So there's no reason to go hacking at the first pitch and make yourself get out. The way to climb back into this game is make him throw pitches. He'll walk a guy or two.
Grounder to short. Smith fields. That ankle's looking fine. Two down. Kind of had the feeling that Indiana was going to challenge him in the field, right?
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't. Grant Smith's one of the best.
Now bring up the left fielder, Hunter Jesse.
You know, with a first baseman or a third baseman with a similar injury, you can pick on them a little bit because you can bunt it at them, right? And then get a base hit out of it and get on base. But shortstop's kind of hard to manipulate.
Four, seems like with the game of baseball, though, like as soon as you make an error, the next one's coming right at you. You get hurt. You feel like you're going to get tested in the field.
Oh, yeah, I know that all too well. Yeah, and you've got to be up and ready for sure.
1-2 to Jesse. Missing low with the fastball. 2-2. Huge shift to the right side on right now for Jesse. Popped him up. Foul territory. Here's Martin, the pitcher, and it's going to be the first baseman, Gillum, making the catch. A 9-pitch inning for Logan Martin as Kentucky with a 4-0 lead after two. Game six here in this Lexington Regional. Let's take a look at what's at stake. If Kentucky wins, they will force a deciding game tomorrow. If Indiana wins, the Hoosiers will advance the Super Regional round. Kentucky the 1 seed, Indiana the 3 seed. Our game moves here into the top of the third with Kentucky on top 4-0. John Schriff and Todd Walker. It's been an outstanding regional here in Lexington, Kentucky. Seen a little of everything so far. And we got plenty of baseball left. Six, seven, eight coming to the plate for the Wildcats. Reuben Church, the DH, will lead it off. Church is only at bat. He was hit by a pitch in the second and will come around a score on that 3-run home run by McCarthy. Breaking ball to not miss by much. 2-1. Hey, win this one, Ben. Win this one. So they are continuing to work on the Kentucky shortstop, Grant Smith. They have now taken his shoe off, and they're going to tape his ankle. Did that hit him again?
Is that four? Four in this game?
This guy, Reuben Church, is just a magnet for the ball. Second time he's hit for a pitch today.
Yeah, 2 hit-by-pitches by Reuben Church, 4 in the game. Free pass for Kentucky in every inning so far.
So the 4th time this game, Kentucky batter's been hit. 16th time here in this regional. Ryan Waldschmidt.
Yeah, again, I mean, Kentucky as a group they're really good at the bunts. But if you're going to bunt, go ahead and square it around a little earlier. Give yourself some time. Get your eyeballs behind the barrel. Put it in an angle so you don't pop it up. And a lot of times, that goes hand in hand. You try to be too quick, the barrel's straight, and you pop it straight up in the air.
Gets the bunt down to the pitcher. Phillips Fields gets the out at first. So back-to-back sacrifice bunts for Waldschmidt as he advances Church down to second.
And now Nolan McCarthy, the big home run back in the second inning.
Here he is, Nolan McCarthy. Last time up, hit a 3-run bomb to left field. Starts him off with a breaking ball for strike one.
I like what Ethan Phillips is doing. He's in command of that slider. He can throw it at any count and land it for a strike.
He was on that fastball, sends it out to right, but Taylor makes the catch. He gave it a ride, but right at the right fielder. Nolan McCarthy's now 1-for-2. Yeah. Here's Grant Smith. Just had his ankle taped. It's that right ankle. Here's his first plate appearance since turning the ankle.
No way.
And that hits him. Todd, you ever seen anything like this? A team just a magnet for the ball like this?
Well, or the other way around. Pitchers throwing to targets. 17 batters hit by a pitch in this regional, and this is Kentucky's only their fourth game.
Unbelievable. First and second, two out, top of the lineup. Jackson Gray, they check on the runner. Church at second.
You know, and I feel like, John, that they preach that a little more nowadays, like get hit, get on base. I didn't like it. So I wanted to hit, number one. But number two, just like anybody else, I mean, I was a right-handed thrower, left-handed hitter, and back then we didn't really wear a bunch of armor. So if I got hit in that right elbow, I was out of the game. And so for me, I was ducking and darting and moving out of the way. And, you know, again, as a left-handed hitter, you got a little more time against right-handed pitchers, so it was more difficult for them to pin me. The lefty-on-lefty matchup was tougher. I got hit more often that way, but it feels like nowadays they really preach, we don't move, we stay put, you know, and if you're going to throw it inside, we're going to take it.
Well, to your point, when you wear all the protection, that's probably a big part of it.
Good point, yeah. And that came around toward the end of my career where guys were starting to armor up.
1-1 to Gray, late on the all-speed pitch, 1-2.
Seems like Jackson Gray's always beating his chest, that two-strike fight. He's always in the hole with two strikes, but he's so good with his two-strike approach. That's why he was able to lay off that nasty pitch right there, is a quick bat speed, letting it travel deep in the zone. The way you swing and wave at that is you're looking for a fastball and you try to get the barrel out in front, but Jackson Gray does a nice job of letting it travel back. His ego doesn't get involved, so he doesn't have to get the barrel out and pull a fastball. He can get jammed. There's a lot of hits getting jammed as a hitter, and just take it the other way.
Up and away, count is full.
Now, with nowhere to put him, even though there's no guarantee it's going to be fastball, is the time when you can open up a little bit, try to get the barrel out. But there's no guarantee that Ethan Phillips is just going to lay it in there. He's really good with that slider.
30th pitch from Phillips. Lifted out into left center field, giving chase is Whalen. Back in left is Jesse making the catch and will end the threat. Kentucky leaves runners on at first and second. It's 4-0. We go to the bottom of the third. John Striffen alongside former LSU star and big leaguer Todd Walker on the call for game six here in this Lexington regional. We have reached the regional final. Kentucky eliminated West Virginia earlier today, 10-0. And Kentucky with a 4-0 lead over Indiana. Kentucky must win today to stay alive. Here's Indiana's Peter Cerruto. Smith fields that short, makes the out. All right, let's show you what happened last night. Peter Cerruto hits a three-run bomb as he's crossing home plate to celebrate. Second baseman Tyler Cerny brings out the celebration chain, and it was on the field. You are not allowed to do that. He was ejected, forced to leave the stadium. Not only ejected from last night, but he was suspended one game. So because he's not out there, Evan Goforth will get the start at second base. And for Goforth at the plate in the nine hole right now, it's his first start since March 14th. That game was actually right here at Kentucky. Goforth lifts this one to center. Gray going back at the wall. Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. That's a home run. Whoa, off the glove of Gray, and Evan Goforth has a home run.
We have a Jose Canseco moment.
Very often.
No. Been a while since Jose Canseco hit off his head and went over the fence. How about Jackson Gray? Almost a fantastic play up against the wall. That ball carried 9-0. Evan Goforth getting the start today and giving Indiana a little bit of life. After a little bit of just a lull for three innings, now in the bottom of the third, the nine spot, Goforth, big fly.
Goforth, that was just his second hit of the season. Let's take a look at this because we got a SportsCenter not top 10 nominee right here.
That's crazy. Yeah, that play you don't see at all. Like, I've seen 10,000 baseball games. I don't think I've seen that other than it hitting Canseco's head. That's amazing.
Move over, Jose Canseco. It is 4-1 now. Kentucky on top here in the bottom of the third. Top of the lineup, Glasser. He'll foul this one out of play, 1-2. And I don't know if Goforth is going to take that chain off.
Yeah, pretty cool moment.
But do not bring it onto the field.
No, sir.
One ball, two strikes, the count on Glasser. The leg of Glasser fouls it off.
Yeah, those hurt. There's nothing but bone below that kneecap. And as a right-hander that throws the slider into the left-hander, I was a left-handed hitter, and you go after that pitch, I mean, it is coming with some high velocity from that barrel down to your ankle or wherever it hits. That's another piece of armor you use there on your shin for that reason.
Two balls, two strikes, the count on Glasser. Martin misses. It's now full. And you look at the pitch count for Logan Martin starting to creep up. Eighth pitch of the at bat. This one is laced into center field for a single. Back-to-back hits for Indiana. Second time through the lineup.
Logan Martin looked really good through the first and second inning. Now in the third, starting to see a little dent in the armor. Home run by Goforth gives a little life to that Indiana dugout. And now they've turned the lineup over. Glasser with the base hit.
Kentucky has left a lot of runners on base. They've had opportunities the first three innings. And now here's Indiana with that home run. Does that change the momentum for the Hoosiers down by three?
You would think so. You need somebody to spark it. And wherever it comes from, the most unlikely guy in this lineup, probably Evan Goforth, just getting his first start in a month or two and crashes it out to center field. And you can feed off that for sure.
So for Kentucky, starting to get some guys warm in the bullpen as Logan Martin has started to slow down just a bit. That is Evan Byers, the lefty, just starting to get loose. Count to the center fielder Bobby Whalen. You know, Todd, you called it. You said early on you noticed how Logan Martin was just really fired up and wondered how much energy he was using. And he has certainly slowed down dramatically here in this third inning.
Yeah, he's throwing some high energy pitches, and that usually will get you through the third. And then the fourth inning on, you start to see if how long he can last. And he's certainly pumping it in there, you know, mid-90s with the max effort slider and the changeup. And he's been really good. Got touched up a little bit in this inning.
Got his sign. Two balls and a strike to count on Whalen. Late on that fastball. 94 from Martin. With one out here in the third, here's the 50th pitch of the ball game from Martin. Slow grounder to second. Fielded by Petre, and he gets the out at first.
Good concentration by Petre at second base. That's tough because you got the runner running right in front of you. And initially, you want to turn the double play. You recognize it's not hit hard enough, and you just get the force. But again, the distraction of the runner can usually take you off of being able to make that play. A nice job by staying under it for the second baseman, Petre.
Devin Taylor walked in his first at bat in the first. Hammers that breaking ball into right. One hops the right field to McCarthy. They're sending the runner at Indiana. They're going to score. Philip Glasser, an RBI single for Devin Taylor. And Indiana now trails by two here in the third.
And now one swing away from tying this game up. Indiana's not going to go away. We still got a long way in this ballgame. And we already know how talented this offense is.
Brock Tibbetts with two outs, runner on at first. And on the hands, fights off that fastball for strike one. Logan Martin does get out of this inning, how long does Kentucky stick with their starter, knowing that this is a must-win game? 1-1 to Tibbetts. Tibbetts just underneath, and this one gets out of play. 2-2.
Well, Kentucky still has to play another game if they win this one, so that takes into consideration how long you're going to leave Logan Martin out there. In addition to the score, so I think it'll depend on how quickly he can get this last out.
The 2-2 to Tibbetts. Way outside. It's now full. Five pitches in the first inning. Here's the 23rd pitch here in this third inning. And Indiana continues to make Martin work. Tibbetts had a 7-pitch at bat in the first. Here's his 7th pitch coming here in the third. A 3-2. Got him looking. Strike three. A quality pitch from Logan Martin, but Indiana gets on the board. A solo home run from Evan Goforth, the RBI single from Devin Taylor, and it's a 4-2 game for Kentucky. Jeff Mercer will be on the headset after this. Welcome back to the Lexington Regional Final. John Schriff and Todd Walker, Kentucky with a 4-2 lead over Indiana. Please be joined by the Hoosiers head coach, Jeff Mercer. Jeff, What an unusual play in that last half inning. A home run by Evan Goford. But it seemed like it gave you guys some life, some momentum. What's the feeling in the dugout right now for Indiana?
Yeah, it looked like that Jose Canseco play back in the day, and obviously it didn't put out that exact way, but it was a bit of a unique play. But, no, you get to a second time in the lineup, and you got to get a chance to see him a little bit. You know, this is a decent profile for us offensively. We should be able to handle the fastball. It's forcing him. He throws hard. He's doing a good job. But second time through the lineup, and we got to get settled in here a little bit and just keep chipping away and working. And I do know this about the boys, like win or lose, they won't quit. They'll fight all the way to the end of it and got to get back in. Like we always say, get to the seventh inning in a two-run game one way or the other and see what happens.
Well, Coach, we know you've got a young group and a lot of talented kids. I mean, you've won 43 games this year. How impressive is that? And especially the opportunity to get in a regional like this. Talk about the experience these kids are getting.
Yeah, you're getting real-world experience now, right? You're getting on-the-job training, and they've done such a great job all year of just, you know, fighting through whatever it is, adversity, injuries, learn how to play the game, learn how to play as a team, learn how to build your identity. They've just done such a great job. I'm the proudest coach in the world. I love these guys and just couldn't be happier for them.
Congratulations on an incredible season. One win away from the Super Regional round. Jeff Mercer, head coach for Indiana. Good luck.
Thank you so much. Have a nice night. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Always so polite.
Yeah, very nice. Yeah, it's fun to talk to, knows the game. And maybe he gets enough credit, maybe he doesn't. But what he's doing at Indiana where, you know, he said it, you trust your recruiting process. That's the first thing. You get a lot of talented young kids in a program where you preach loyalty and you preach family. And you let them play. And he said they took their lumps over the last year or two. And, you know, they got five of the nine guys in this hitting lineup that are freshmen or sophomores. And they're built for the future. And now, he didn't get to relax, but it's a little less difficult now than it was a year ago. And he's starting to see the product of what he's built.
Well, in the meantime, Kentucky just had their sixth batter hit by a pitch. Chase Felker, second time he's been hit tonight. So the leadoff runner on for Kentucky, and that'll bring up Devin Burks. Shows bunt, pulls it back, strike one. Kentucky's had the leadoff hitter aboard every single inning. And they pushed across four, but it feels like they could have scored a lot more already.
I mean, Indiana's only given up four hits, and they've given away seven free passes. I mean, imagine how different this game looks by just throwing strikes.
Foul tip into the mitt, strike two.
Sorry, eight free passes, six hits by pitch and two walks.
Going to the count on the Kentucky catcher, Burks. Checking on the runner again. Ethan Phillips, the second pitcher used today by Indiana. Trying to get the first out here in this fourth, the 0-2. So for two today, into a double play in the first, struck out in the second. And time is called at the plate.
Well, it's a time violation.
Time violation, correct.
Time and time.
So a Pitchcock violation against Ethan Phillips. A ball is awarded to Burks, 2-2. To the count, nobody out, runner on at first. Pitch from Phillips, grounded left side, and it's foul.
You heard baseball's game of inches?
Foul by much.
I mean inches. Third base umpire Tim Cordell. I mean, wow. If that's foul, it's not even inches. It's millimeters.
It looks like it's a great call. It looked like it did just scoot to the left side of that third base bag.
Well, Tim Cordell's right on top of it. So, I mean, it, you know, he had the best view.
Tough call live, but you said it. Tim Cordell was right there. 3-2. And he hit him. Look at Burks. That pumps him up.
I don't know if I've ever seen this, John.
I know I haven't. I've never seen anything like this. It's not like they're throwing at the Kentucky hitters on purpose.
No.
But the ball just seems to find them one way or another. This is unreal. And that's not even close.
It's the second time today that Devin Burks has been hit right square in the back.
Seventh Kentucky hitter hit by a pitch. Not the regional, just today alone in this game. Seven.
Yeah, I'm sure I haven't seen that. Now, I've seen 7, 8, 9, 10 walks, but six different guys get hit by a pitch, and look at Felker.
So Indiana will make the call to the bullpen. Nobody out. Runners on at first and second here in the top of the fourth. Kentucky on top, 4-2. New pitcher for Indiana. The third pitcher today will be the righty, Luke Hayden.
Yeah, they need him to throw strikes. They're still in this game. Indiana, it feels like Kentucky's got a 10-run lead, but they don't. They've had so many guys on base. Seven hit by pitches, two walks, nine free passes, four hits, and they're Indiana's down by two.
Kentucky has left six runners on base so far today. We're just here in the fourth. So the first two Kentucky batters hit by a pitch. Felker's on at second, Burks is on at first. Brings up Emilian Petre. First pitch to him is a fastball for strike one. Hayden making his 14th appearance of the season. He's got an elevated ERA, but they need him now. Nobody out here in this top of the fourth. One ball, two strikes to count on Petre. Yeah, 2-2 to Petre. Fastball pulled to the right side, chopper to first. Only play for Tibbetts will be to step on the bag to get the out. Petre does his job and advances the runners to second and third with one down.
We've seen a lot of those high choppers on this turf, and it gets the job done, moves the runners up, first out. Nice decision by Tibbetts. Sometimes you'll see a first baseman try to force that double play in the second, throw it in the left field, and then chaos. Nice decision just to get the out.
Hunter Gillum will step in, one for two. Held a swing, strike one. Singleton scored and grounded out in the same inning back in the second. Mm, 97 from Luke Hayden. Here's the 0-2. Gillum right on that one. Sends it out to center field. That'll score two. Throw comes into second. And RBI, two RBI single for Hunter Gillum as Kentucky extends their lead 6-2.
Well, that's a mistake by Luke Hayden. Had him 0-2. You want to try to throw a competitive pitch that gets a swing and miss either in the dirt or on the outside corner. Lee catches too much part of the plate to the 5-0 Hunter Gillum, and he makes a play already with a base hit in this game back in the second. Second base hit of the game and extends the Cats' lead 6-2. Stays on that ball just enough. Hit it off the end, but drops in front of the center fielder, Whalen.
So both.
That pitch right there is what they were looking for, John.
Yeah. Reuben Church steps in. He's been hit by a pitch both times. He's been up to the plate. And both batters who were hit by a pitch came around to score for Kentucky. Count to the six-hole hitter, Reuben Church. One, two from Hayden. Got him swinging with a fastball, 97. There's two down. The NCAA Regionals coverage for all 16 sites continues tomorrow on ESPN Plus and the ESPN app. For more information, visit NCAA.com, the home for all 90 NCAA championships. Luke Hayden's come out of the bullpen. He's throwing strikes for Indiana. Ryan Walshman at the plate.
Yeah, Luke Hayden's got some good stuff. Fastball's up to 97. You saw the cutter at 90 miles an hour. Can manipulate that fastball a little bit. Jeff Mercer will tell you, he's got the best arm talent on the team. Just needs to work on a little poise. But he can really throw it. Slider works too.
What was that? I mean, we've seen a little of everything in this one. Yeah, time for a little baby shark.
Just slip out of his hand. Oh, yeah, well, he didn't. He tried to avoid the balk by getting rid of the ball. That's actually some quick thinking. The only thing left that would have happened there is if Waltzman would have hit it off the ground.
We already have two SportsCenter not top 10 nominees. Two balls and a strike to count on the left fielder Walt Schmidt. Fastball a little in, 3-1. So officially it was called a wild pitch as Church goes on to take second.
It's pretty wild.
Because he did get rid of it. And that one gets past Cerruto. Church goes down to third off the walk. Excuse me, that's Gillum. I apologize. So Gillum goes to third on the wild pitch. First and third with two outs.
Seven hit by pitch, three walks, and three wild pitches for Indiana in this game.
Nolan McCarthy, one for two, got that three-run home run. Swings through the fastball, strike one. Hitting over 300 on the season with his third home run today. Grounded to the left side, scooped nicely at third by Pine. Off the short hop will make the play. So Kentucky strands two more. But they pick up two more runs. It is 6-2. We'll talk to Kentucky head coach Nick Mingione after this. Welcome back to the regional final here in Lexington, Kentucky. With a 6-2 lead over Indiana, move to the bottom of the fourth inning. John Schriff and Todd Walker. Please be joined by Kentucky head coach Nick Mingione. And coach, we got to start with the hit by pitches. I got to say, I've never seen anything like this. Seven hit by pitches today, 19 here in this regional. As the coach, are you concerned or are you just welcome it on?
Man, this is what Kentucky's all about. We don't move. We're tough. And this didn't just start with this team. There's a lot of guys that have worn this jersey before, and I know they're watching right now that they've done the same thing for Kentucky. So five last game, right? Seven this one. That's 13 on the day if my math's right. Oh, no, wait, 12. But, man, our guys are just tough, man. They want to win for Kentucky. That's all I can say. The only way you do that is if you're unselfish and you're tough.
Mins, you led the tough SEC in batting average at 282. You've got to love what your offense has done today.
Yeah, you know, and that's one part of it, Todd. You know this. Hitting and batting average is one, and there are six components to offense. And your ability to control the strike zone and stand in there and take pitches, your ability to draw walks and hit, those are all part of offense. And, you know, in order to lead in hitting, you got to do a lot of other things well, too. And, you know, we got to keep going. This game is far from over.
6-2, you got the lead. Kentucky head coach Nick Mingione, thanks for joining us.
Yeah, thanks, guys.
5-6-7 coming up. Evan Byers, new pitcher on the mound for Kentucky.
That left-handed sophomore only has 15 innings on the year, and that's always impressive to me. You know, you know you're going to need a lot of arms, whether it's through the SEC tournament or any tournament of a conference, and then, of course, as you go along in a regional and super. And the numbers are good for Evan Byers, 1.2 ERA. You've already seen the slider and the fastball with the cut, lefty-on-lefty matchup. Can sidewind on you a little bit if he needs to. Only giving up two runs all year.
Did not go around there, 2-2. Matheson flew out to right, his first at bat in the second. Leaves that one outside, full count. Matheson lifts this one to right, and it is not coming back. A solo home run for the Indiana DH, Carter Matheson. His 10th home run of the season, and Indiana cuts into the lead. It's now 6-3 here in the fourth.
That's pretty good plate coverage. with the lefty-on-lefty matchup. Carter Matheson gets the barrel out on a slider away and knocks it out to right field. Second home run given up by Evan Byers this year.
So Josh Pine will step in 0-for-1, grounded out in the second. Second time Indiana's rocking that home run chain. Evan Goforth had a solo home run in the third. Now Matheson here in the fourth. Golfing that one, a grounder to short. Smith fields on the run and just does get Pine. Let's take a look at this home run by Matheson.
Ball just moving away. Everything lefty on lefty usually moves away from the barrel. And that's what I mean, you know, and as a hitter, if you're the lefty Carter Matheson, you kind of lean in as it's moving to the outside corner of the plate, catch the barrel, get it up in the air to right field here in Lexington, and you know it's going to go. And people don't know that about hitting, too. You can manipulate your body a little bit to try to find the barrel where it's an inside pitch, you move your hands in, or an outside pitch where you lean out over the plate.
Petre at second makes it look easy. Two down here in this bottom of the fourth.
Yeah, this up the middle duo, Petre and Smith, is pretty good. And I like what Smith did earlier. You know, he keeps his glove below the ball as he's coming in, works through the baseball with his glove, and just makes a pretty difficult play seem easy.
Head coach Nick Mingione talking about the toughness of his guys to get hit by pitches. How about the toughness of Grant Smith at shortstop with his ankle taped up after sliding in home at first inning, continuing to keep it warm, moving around. He has been fielding his position no problem at short.
Yeah, and they need him. Again, the consistency that he brings to the table is just as good as it gets in the country.
Peter Cerruto, the catcher, 1-1. That pitch misses down, 2-1. Cerruto with that big three-run home run last night to give Indiana the win. Swings over the top of that off-speed pitch, 2-2. The 3-2, good piece from Cerruto. Sends a charge into left center field. Cut off and left by Waldschmidt, but Cerruto will have a two-out double in the bottom of the fourth. For Cerruto, his fifth double of the season.
And here come the Hoosiers. Like you heard Coach Jeff Mercer say, they're not going to go down quietly. We're still only in the bottom of the fourth. It feels like this game has been heavily on the Wildcats. But only a three-run deficit. Home run, now a double from the eighth spot, Peter Cerruto.
Here's Evan Goforth. Last time up, had that bizarre home run in center field. This time he grounds it to short, gobbled up by Smith, and fires a strike to first. Indiana strands the runner at second, but they do get one back off the home run by Carter Matheson. Kentucky leads it 6-3 after four. College World Series. You first got to get through the regional round. And who will make it out of this Lexington regional? We started with four. We're down to our final two teams. Kentucky must win tonight to stay alive. If Indiana loses, they will be a final game tomorrow for the champion here in this Lexington regional. Top five we go. 6-3, Kentucky on top. Bottom of the lineup, Grant Smith, his third at bat. Singleton scored in the second, hit by a pitch in the third. Luke Caden on the mound for his second inning of relief for Indiana. Grounded to the left side. Nice diving stab by Pine at third. What a play. One down.
That's the second really nice play we've seen from Pine over at third base.
Now back, the center fielder, number 51, Jackson Gray.
I mean, the ability to react. I mean, watch. And he's in. He's not even back. The reaction to his left, get up, gather yourself, and make an accurate throw over to first base. Dude is playing some third base.
Top of the lineup, fourth at bat for Jackson Gray. Walked in the first, hit by a pitch in the second, and flew out to left in the third.
Go Jackson!
So Kentucky has had seven batters hit by a pitch today. If you're wondering what the record is in an NCAA tournament game, it is 10. Gotta go back to 1998. That was the College Station Regional. Rice hit 10 Washington hitters. Gotta thank my statistician, Alan Thrifley, for that one.
Yeah, digging deep.
1-2. Two, pounded into the ground, high chopper at third. Pine has no play. An infield single for Jackson Gray. ESPN is the home for the NCAA College Baseball Regionals. For around-the-clock multi-game coverage, scan the QR code below. ESPN Plus subscribers can also access expanded coverage with Squeeze Play. And with regionals coming down to the wire, this is the time to scan that QR code, get in on Squeeze Play. A lot of teams are fighting for their survival right now.
Sometimes the best plays are the plays you don't try to make. Josh Pine, I mean, ate that ball. That again, when you try to force it, that's when you see those balls get thrown in the stands.
How about Jackson Gray at the top of the lineup? That was his first hit here in this regional. Is that the hit that gets the leadoff hitter going for Kentucky?
Well, if you remember me in the last game saying that, that's what's going to break him out. Something weird like that, like just a dink or a bloop. And that's why I always, when I was struggling, I went back to the basics, which was basically mean let the ball travel, get jammed if you have to, stay back on the off speed. And once one pokes through the hole there, it doesn't matter how you got it. You instantly feel better as a hitter.
Chase Felker has been hit by a pitch twice, singled in the second. Lifts this one to left center field. Whalen, the center fielder, will track it down for the second out.
The catcher, number 7, Devin Burks.
Yeah, Kentucky as a team doesn't strike out a ton, but the trade-off is you get pitches like that that you can drive to the pull side, but you're staying back on off speed and you end up flying out. And letting the ball travel a little further. It's a give and take. And so the more home runs you hit, clearly the more strikeouts you're going to have and the more times you take chances. But when you got less strikeouts like Kentucky, you're fighting off two-strike approaches. You're getting on base. You're getting hit by pitches, as we've seen in this game. And you're doing the little things. And Kentucky does it as good as anybody.
Devin Burks last time up, hit by a pitch and scored. Kentucky certainly had their chances. They put up 6, but Todd, it feels like they could be up a lot more. They have left a runner on base every single inning. Well hit. Deep to left center field. Devin Burks, his second home run here in the regional. A solo home run in the first game. Now a two-run shot. Devin Burks has given Kentucky an 8-3 lead here in the fifth.
Ten runs in game one today, 8 runs game two, 18 runs today for Kentucky, and we're only in the fifth inning. This offense has come alive, and Devin Burks out of the 3 spot sparks another 2 runs for the Cats.
The Wildcats bats are finally playing like the one seed. Here's Petre. The first baseman, Tibbetts, he will step on the bag for the final out here in this top of the fifth. But Kentucky adds two more. A two-run shot by Devin Burks. It is 8-3. We move to the bottom of the fifth. And plus, John Shrimp and Todd Walker on the call here in the Lexington Regional Final. Kentucky with a big lead. Let's take a look at the Baton Rouge Regional. The winner of Lexington Regional will face off the Baton Rouge winner. And LSU Oregon State, that'll be on ESPN2. Sam Houston has eliminated Tulane. The loser of the LSU Oregon State game will face off against Sam Houston tonight at 9 p.m. Eastern.
And Oregon State ahead in that game 3-2 as they finish the fourth inning in Baton Rouge.
That regional a little behind everyone else because they've had some weather delays. So they're still at the 1-0 game. But they're trying to get the second elimination game in later tonight in Baton Rouge. Ryan Hagenow, new pitcher on for Kentucky. Top of the lineup, Philip Glasser, Bobby Whalen, Devin Taylor coming up to the plate. Glasser goes the other way, slaps a single to left to start this top of the fifth.
Ryan Hagenow, the 6'5 right-hander from Knoxville. He can get some swing and misses. 30 strikeouts in only 20 innings. The 8 walks is pretty low, 3.5 ERA. He can bring the noise, and what Kentucky needs right now with a 5-run lead is just to throw strikes. Give up base hits, that's okay, but you don't want to be giving away free passes with the lead.
Timeout called by the catcher, Devin Burks, who wants to talk to Hagenow. Second inning in a row, Indiana has the leadoff hitter on board. Philip Glasser, 2-for-3 today. Back-to-back singles, he's on at first. That is his 31st multi-hit game of the season for Glasser. Bobby Whalen 0-for-2 today. Here's the 1-0. Breaking ball misses badly, 2-0. First four innings versus the last five innings. Indiana knows how to finish strong.
Yeah, by the third time through the lineup, these hitters have caught on to the pitching. The timing's down, and if you take a lot of pitches early in the game, that's what can happen. And that's why I always thought, you know, my first at bat, even if I struck out on 6-7 pitches, it was a quality at bat because I saw a lot of pitches. The timing gets down. And if you face the same guy the second, third time around, you've got the muscle memory of what he throws, and it's just an advantage for a hitter.
Whalen taken all the way there. 3 balls and a strike to count to the Indiana center fielder. Pounds it up the middle. This could be two. Smith steps on second over to first. Double play. I think that ankle is just fine for Grant Smith.
Yeah, just ball beat straight back up the middle. That's a nice quality pitch from Hagenow. Ball looks like it's right down the middle and then drops low, and that's why Whalen attacked it and hit it into the ground. Double play. 2 quick outs.
Devin Taylor. You know, at the end of that play, you saw Grant Smith a little gimpy after throwing it over to first. I mean, the job he is doing to gut it out, you can tell that ankle is definitely still bothering him. But he's still delivering in the field.
But you know, you don't have to make the spectacular plays. Just make the routine, and that's, again, what Grant Smith does so well.
Taylor gives it a ride. Foul down that right field line. Two-two. Popped him up. Third baseman Felker will make the catch. Kentucky in control. An 8-3 lead here in this Lexington Regional Final after 5. Welcome back to Lexington Regional. Kentucky needing this win to stay alive. They have brought the bats here today. 10-0 win over West Virginia in the first elimination game. Here they are up 8-3 over Indiana here in the nightcap. Five, six, seven come to the plate. Hunter Gillum swings at that first pitch. A diving stab by Pine, but can't scoop it at first is Tibbetts.
Josh Pine over third base continues to flash it. We've already seen him made almost the identical play last inning. And scoops it up yet again off that turf, but just short hops the first baseman Tibbetts, who tries to go out and get it. And that's a little weird, wasn't able to grab the handle.
Wow, that's a tough score. They ruled out an E5 against Pine.
Yeah, that's when, as a hitter, you're on base and you look up wherever that score is up in the box and give them the double hands in the air or whatever. I hit a ball.
And Kentucky's at home, though.
Yeah, exactly. I hit a ball to Brian Giles one time in the big leagues, and he was running in the gap and full extension. Now, he didn't die, but full extension. It goes off of his, barely off of his glove, and they give me an error on that. And hits are too hard to come by as a hitter. You get pinned with something like that, it makes a difference. And, you know, what ends up being a great play by Josh Pine ends up penalizing him, you know, with an error.
Did you ever get to know the official score when you were at home?
No, because they never played baseball. You know, they were high school mathematicians that, you know, now are calling big league games and, you know, deciding your future and your batting average. No animosity for me.
Church gives this one a ride to center over the head of Whalen. It'll one hop the wall. They're going to hold the runner at third. Second and third for Kentucky off the double from Reuben Church.
Well, they knew Reuben Church had a lot of talent coming into the University of Kentucky a couple of years ago, but injuries and a little bit of inconsistency over the years have kept him out of the lineup. But look at this balanced swing, the extension, and that ball is pelted out to center field and almost jumps over the wall and doesn't. Second and third for Kentucky, already with a 5-run lead. Well, when I said it was first called an average for a reason, this is why, John. I mean, they struggled the first two games, only 7 runs with 3 extra base hits, but it's only a matter of time before a good offense gets hot. And the last two games, which has been today only, 2 games today for Kentucky, 18 runs.
I got a question for you. How is Kentucky allowed to take these timeouts and use this much time between at-bats to talk things over?
I thought we were trying to get this game
a little quicker, right?
Yeah, it's the only team I've ever seen do it. Like, when it comes down to a situation, and this isn't necessarily a situation because you got second, third, nobody out, but Mangione will call them together and he'll ask what they want to do and, you know, kind of talk through the situation. And again,
I get it on Kentucky standpoint, right? You got to use the time if they're going to allow you to do it. If you're the umpires, how do you not break it up? Ryan Walshman at the plate.
Yeah, it's a great point.
Because nothing really happened between pitches there. A double.
And it's not a bunt situation. It's not a steal situation. So, yeah, I mean, maybe Nick Mangione just really loves his players and just wants to talk to them every now and then. I don't know.
Hey, if you're Kentucky and they're going to let you get away with it, do it all day, right?
Why not?
I just thought we were trying to speed things up in baseball and make these games a little quicker. At one. Waldschmidt gives it a ride out to right field. Taylor on the horse cannot find it. It'll get down. Gillum and Church will score. Safe at second. A 2-RBI double by Ryan Waldschmidt. And it's now 10-3, Kentucky on top.
Well, it looked like...
Excuse me, I apologize. One run came in.
Yeah, Reuben Church went back. He either slipped or something happened. To your comment, he certainly should have scored. See if he's out here. I think he might be out there. Looked like he tagged him before that left foot got on the bag, and his foot kind of rises. Tags on right there. Foot's not there yet. But I don't know what happened to Church over at third. He slipped or something happened. He had to go back. So what should have been two runs.
Indiana has challenged the call on the field. It was called safe.
Yeah, so what should have been two runs in and a guy at second might be one run in and an out.
All right, let's take another look at that double by Ryan Waldschmidt, and we'll look at the base paths too to see what happened with Church.
That's the ball that hit down the right field. Ryan Church takes off. He recognized it right away. So I don't know why. I mean, I don't know why he was held up. The ball came into second base, and they clearly were focused on making the tag there. They assumed that they were going to score both runs. He was held up at third base. He got too good of a jump. He was right behind Gillum, but he was held up. I don't know. What do you think, John? I thought he got him.
It looks like the tag was applied right before the foot gets to the bag. Right there.
Right there. Yeah. And then he pops the bag. Yeah. I mean, Stephen McMullen, the second base umpire, can't be any closer. I mean, his nose is right there on the bag. Wonder how this new system.
A review right now.
Yeah. John, I wonder how this new system affects these umpires. You know, you make a call and then it gets overturned and you're like, dang it, I missed it.
Well, you can't fault the umpires. That was a bang bang play. I mean, easily it could have gone either way. We have instant replay in an effort to just get it right, not to blame anyone for getting a call right or wrong, you know?
Yeah, I get it. And, you know, what is it? 8 or 9 times out of 10, they're right.
For sure.
But I just wonder occasionally, you know, if you. And that, yeah, you're right. I mean, that was so close in real time. It's tough to tell.
So the call is overturned. Waldschmidt is thrown out at second. A good throw by Taylor in right. It was a single, and he was thrown out at second by the right fielder for Indiana. And Church was held at third. So one out, runner on at third. Nolan McCarthy comes up to the plate.
Yeah, it ends up something that's probably not going to matter since it's now a 6-run lead. But, man, 2 runs in, second base, nobody out, turns into 1 run in and a guy out. And sole runner still sitting at third base. That's a big difference.
Maybe Kentucky figured with nobody out, why risk sending the runner from third?
Especially with the lead, you know, and that big of a deal. We talked about it earlier with the stolen base down by 7 by West Virginia. They're trying to steal third base. You know, it's a deal where you go station to station. Even if you're up by 6, certainly if you're down by 6, you're going to go station to station. But even in this situation, you're right. You kind of want to make sure. You don't want to keep getting blown up on the bases.
2-1, fouled off at the plate. 2-2, the count on McCarthy. Two two to the Kentucky right fielder McCarthy. Hammers that one right at the second baseman. Go for the out. And there's 2 down.
Nolan McCarthy is swinging the bat well. Home run in the second inning, a bullet to right in the third, and now another missile right at second base. Sophomore.
So a hard out, second out here in this top of the sixth for Kentucky. Grant Smith takes that breaking ball for strike one. Smith lifts this one in the air to center. Whalen will make the catch, and Kentucky will strand that runner from third, but they do pick up another. The Wildcats lead it 9-3. We move to the bottom of the sixth. 9-3 over Indiana. Brock Tibbetts, first pitch. One hops the wall in right center field. So Tibbetts will start this bottom of the sixth with a double.
John, the Clemson story is incredible. They were 8 2/3 away from, you know, one more out away from being in the winner's bracket and not having to play that morning game. And that went into, you know, deep past midnight last night out in Clemson. Tennessee gets them in the 14th. They got to get up, play Charlotte, lose that game by one run. And all of a sudden, within less than 24 hours, they lost two games and they're out.
That's how quickly it can happen, right? You're really, literally a strike away from being in the driver's seat in the regional, and now you're home.
And watching that Tennessee-Clemson game, you kind of had that feeling, because this is such a mental game anyway. But you play an exhausting 14-inning game and lose it, and then have to get up at 7, 8 a.m. and play another game for your life on the line. It's just almost impossible.
Ryan Hagen now on the mound. 1-2 pitch. About LSU, Oregon State. LSU now has a 4-3 lead over Oregon State. That's the 1-0 game in the Baton Rouge regional.
Yeah, I've tracked that. The LSU offense and the Florida offense, I mean, they are high, high powered. And it is going to be very difficult to keep that offense down for Oregon State.
Back-to-back home runs for LSU. They lead it 4-3 after five innings. The 2-2 to Matheson. Where did that miss?
Yeah, if it missed, it was low, and that's a good eye. But as a hitter, I never liked leaving it up to that umpire. Anything close, that's part of the two-strike approach. Expand the zone and go after it.
3-2. Laces this one over the shortstop's head. Tibbetts, he will round third. He will score. An RBI single for Carter Matheson. And Indiana now trails 9-4 here in the sixth.
Still 12 outs for Indiana, down by five, and this game's far from over. And you heard Coach Jeff Mercer talk about the fight. Every team, you assume, is going to fight for it. But this is a talented offense with Indiana. They can pile some runs together quickly.
You know, another score we didn't mention. TCU Arkansas 20-5. TCU won. And Trey Richardson had three home runs, two grand slams for TCU in that game. Unreal.
It's amazing with that kid. What a day, huh? But almost as amazing as Hagen Smith's one of the best pitchers in the country. I mean, that kid is a true ace and just got lit up.
Richardson,
three walks in the
11
first inning.
RBI in that game. That tied the record for most in a single postseason game in the NCAA tournament. Josh Pine, he has flashed the leather at third, made a couple of diving stabs. Finds himself in the hole at the plate. One ball, two strikes. Popped him up. Shallow right field. Second baseman Petre will make the catch for the first out here in the bottom of the sixth. All right, so we're talking about all the games, all the exciting action going on across the country. Here's where you can find it. ESPN, the home for all of the NCAA baseball regionals. If you want around-the-clock multi-game coverage, scan this QR code on the screen. ESPN Plus subscribers can also access expanded coverage with Squeeze Play. A lot of guys putting up big numbers across the country. Put this on the main screen and then put on Squeeze Play. We'll keep you up to date what's going on. Hunter Jesse. Oh, what a diving grab in center by Gray. Makes up for giving up that home run. And now, he got a potential Sports Center nominee top 10.
I'm not sure Jackson Gray gave up the home run. He certainly helped it over the fence. But what a nice play. The Superman coming in for Jackson Gray. Full extension, lays out, loses the glasses in the process for the second out. And when you have a team trying to come back, that is a rally killer. Nice job by Jackson Gray in center field.
That'll make the young man feel better about himself out in center. Catcher Peter Cerruto. And a strike to count to the Indiana catcher. Goes the other way. Fly ball right field. McCarthy is there for the catch. Indiana picks up one. After six innings of play, Kentucky 9, Indiana 4. We'll be back to the Lexington Regional Final after this. Second inning. What a shot for Nolan McCarthy. And it was Hunter Gillum getting in on the action. And in the fifth, Devin Burks, the two-run bomb to left center field. Kentucky bats have exploded today. 10 runs in the first elimination game against West Virginia. 9 runs here today. Here's a look at what's at stake. If Kentucky wins, they force a deciding game tomorrow. If Indiana wins, the Hoosiers will win the regional and move on to the super regional round.
New pitcher on the mound, Cooper Hellman. He's got the sinker, the four-seam fastball up to 90 miles an hour. It does have a change in the slider. Indiana thinks he's got one of the best sliders in the country. But has a lot of movement, and he's still trying to corral that thing in. 6'4". 180-pound sophomore has got some good stuff.
Jackson Gray will lead things off top of the lineup for Kentucky. In front of that first pitch, rips it foul down that right field line. Gray in his last at bat in the fifth, picked up his first hit here in this regional. How about the bite from that one on Hellman?
Yeah, that's in the report. Again, the only thing left is for him to be able to control it.
Left the breaking ball up, and Gray hammered it. Gray with back-to-back hits now. And he starts off the seventh inning with a single.
There he is. And what do we say about getting that cheap first base hit? It can get you moving. Got a big, and I say cheap, every hit's a nice hit if you're a hitter, but popped it straight up in the air to third, beats it out, and now feels a little better about himself. And the first ball, he's really squared up in this whole tournament, a rip up the middle. Second base hit of the game for Jackson Gray.
Kentucky has now had the leadoff hitter aboard 6 of 7 innings. Chase Felker, the lefty, steps in, 1-0 count.
I'm going to be singing that song in my sleep. Baby, baby shark.
I was just thinking that.
Oh, my goodness. There was a closer for McNeese State a couple years ago in a regional that would come out to that song.
The 2-0 to Felker. I wonder what the significance is. If there's any Kentucky fans out there who know, shoot us a tweet at John Schriffen. Would love to know. Might be just as simple as it's a fun song. Maybe it's an annoying song. Who knows? 3-0. Oh, I like, just got to pick the bat back up.
Yeah. Umpires don't like that. But what I do like is that you throw your Twitter out there for just about anybody, and as if they can spell your last name. That's pretty good.
That's so true. West Virginia fans found me the other night.
Yeah, right away.
They were nice.
Yeah,
they were kind. They were very positive.
Absolutely.
Hammered down the line, foul. 3-2, count. I'll send him your way, Todd Walker.
That'd be great. My Twitter feed has been disconnected. I did one game 8 years ago, and all of a sudden I had 150 tweets. I'm like, wow, they love me, you know. Went and started looking at it. Oh, my goodness. Said, you know what, it's probably not a good idea to allow people to talk trash to you when there's no repercussion, you know. So I kind of got rid of that.
3-2 count on the third baseman, Kentucky, checking on the runner again. It's amazing how much concentration these college athletes have to deal with social media, all the pressures, deal with school, everything going on around, and focus on the game. It is impressive. Wow.
Guess what?
Another hit batter.
I tried to look up the record for hit by pitches in a game. They can tweet that at you as well as anybody out there that's got time to look that up. But this has been.
Got it. We know what it is. It's at 10. 10 in a game is the record.
Well, we've got 8, right?
We're at 8 right now. Devin Burks. Last time up, that 2-run home run in the 5th. You know, I'm kind of surprised more teams don't go with this strategy. Ball's coming at you. Just don't get out of the way. Take it. Eat it. Get the free pass.
Yeah, maybe what I explained for 20 years ago, we didn't really have the armor. So I didn't have the luxury of taking it off my elbow as a left-handed hitter because I was a right-handed thrower. But in addition to that, I wanted to hit. I'm not letting you just allow me on first. I want a double. I want a triple, a homer, driving some runs. And so that was my thinking through college. And then when you get to the big leagues and it's 100 miles an hour from everybody you face, it's not that easy just to sit there and wear it, because that you're going to feel that for a while. You can do it. You made a good point. You can do it a little easier in this day and age because you've got you look like a soldier up there with all the gear and the armor that they wear. But 25 years ago, it was a little more difficult.
All right, Todd, I already got some responses on Twitter. Gabe Daddy, Peyton Barnhill got back to me. So they said that they played Baby Shark here at Kentucky Proud Park on a 2-0 count.
Oh, my goodness.
Both runners advance, thrown past Burks. What is going on?
I mean, if the intention is to just let it hit you, wouldn't he have just stood there? He actually moved.
I mean, that thing would have hit him in the face.
Doesn't he know they're two away from the record? So we get Baby Shark if this is a ball?
Correct.
Okay.
So I did not get an explanation why. I'm not sure why they play it, but it's a thing at Kentucky Proud Park. Yeah. 2-0.
And cue the music.
I don't hear it.
Nothing.
Okay. The 2-0. 3-0, and it gets past the catcher, Cerruto. Here comes the run. Gray will score. It is 10-4 Kentucky off the wild pitch.
Just too many free bases and free passes for Indiana in this game. 8 hit by pitches, 5 wild pitches, 3 walks.
Reno the count on Burks. Ball 4. I mean, Todd, if this score holds and Kentucky goes on to the win and forces a deciding game tomorrow, how do you regroup from this if you're Indiana? So many hit by pitches, so many free passes. Not the way they've been playing this season.
No, and it puts a major emphasis on who you're going to start to set the tone for the game tomorrow if this score holds up. But I tell you what, you give Cerruto a lot of credit behind the plate. I mean, this game's kind of out of hand out here in the seventh inning, down by 6. And that dude's still back there blocking up balls and taking bruises.
So it looks like Indiana's going to make another call to the bullpen. Runners on at first and third. Nobody out. And we will take this break with them. Kentucky with a 10-4 lead here in this top of the 7th. We'll be back to Lexington after this. We look at our bracket. Kentucky got the win earlier today in the elimination game, 10-0. This is their second game of the day. And they are in control right now over Indiana. Kentucky, if they win, they will force a deciding Game 7. It'll be tomorrow, right back here in Lexington. If Indiana comes back to win, they take the entire regional and will move on to the Supers. John Schriffen alongside Todd Walker. A pitching change for Indiana. 10-4, Kentucky on top right now here in the top of the 7th.
Adrian Vega, sophomore on the mound, fastball in the high 80s. Developed a cutter, but it's primarily fastball slider. Gotta love this kid's story. Sold his car to afford his tuition at Butler. He's the Butler transfer from last year to this year. Elevated ERA, only 18 innings pitched. Getting a chance to get a little experience here in the postseason.
Here's Emilian Petre at the dish. Got a chance to do some damage with nobody out. You know, I love that story. We talk about in the era of NIL, everyone thinks college players are making so much money. That's not the case for every sport. And you got guys who just love it and just want to be a part of the college atmosphere, do whatever they can to play the game.
And go to school just to get into college, you know. Some guys, yep, you know, do all they can. And you got to love Vega for wanting to get that you know, that academic deal in addition to getting the opportunity to play at Butler and now at Indiana.
And I love NIL. I think that what college athletes have to do, it is a full-time job to play any sport. So if you can give them some extra cash, I'm all for it. The 2-0 to Petre. In there for a strike, 2-1.
Yeah, and times have changed, John. I mean, I had a 25% scholarship when I first signed up at LSU. Next year, it was 50%, so half scholarship. And by the third year, I had about 75%. But
barreled up by Petre, right center field. One hops the wall. Felker will score. They're going to hold Burks at third. And an RBI double for Emilian Petre.
First hit of the day for Emilian Petre, if you can believe that. He's been on base once back in the second inning with the walk. And this ball is just out over the plate. And gets down and dirty with it. Right center field, a double for the four spot. Emilian Petre and the Cats keep tacking on.
Okay, what do we call that dance?
Man, we were so stoic when I played. I can't even relate. You know, I mean, I kind of imagine what we would have done. You know, you get on second, and it was, you know, we were from the era where if you did something good, you were supposed to, and if you didn't, you got hammered for it. So, I guess that's the old school way of thinking. They have a little more fun nowadays.
Hunter Gillum at the plate. Nobody out still. Runners on at second and third. I love the fact that Kentucky, a team with their back against the wall, in this elimination game potentially for them, they're still having fun with it. And that's what college baseball should be about.
Yeah, and it's a little easier to have fun when you're up by seven.
But 100%. I get that.
I think that I saw Mangione even say that in the meeting, and you can clearly imagine that both these coaches are telling these kids to have fun. And you always hear that term, and I remember playing for all those years. The times when I genuinely did have fun, I played better. But it's so hard to do with the stress and the pressure and everything that goes along with it that it's just hard to tap into sometimes.
Here's the 0-2 to Gillum. Bounced Cerruto. He saves a run there. Man, how many runs has he saved behind the plate for Indiana?
Oh, man. And again, he's still working. Down by seven. You know, you have a feel that, you know, as a player for Indiana, this game's a little out of hand. And Cerruto behind the plate is still doing his job.
1-2 to Gillum. Pulled the hands in. Just pose on him. Uh-oh. Going back and gone. A three-run jack for Hunter Gillum. His 12th of the season. And this one's getting silly. It is all Wildcats.
I think we made him mad by talking about the first two games and the lack of offense that this Kentucky lineup was doing, and that ball was blasted. And you said it best, the ability to pull your hands in to find the barrel. Again, you get extension too early on that and it hits you off the hands. But Gillum gets down with that and smokes it to left field. Three-run homer for the Cats. And the offense today, 10 runs in the first game, 14 runs against Indiana in this second game. And we're not done yet.
Todd, Kentucky's got that swagger right now. They are feeling themselves. This is a dangerous team right now. I know Indiana's technically in the driver's seat, but Kentucky, man, they have got all the confidence right now.
Yeah, not anymore. After this game, it'll be tied, and the best thing happening for Indiana is they get to wait a day to play the next one, because I bet if you asked Kentucky, they'd want to play that next game right after this one.
Two balls and a strike to count to the DH, Reuben Church. Vega. The third time Reuben Church is hit by a pitch today. The ninth Kentucky batter to hit by a pitch today. And he gets the pass to first.
We won't see this again in our lifetime, John. I mean, I've been through 30 years of baseball. and 9 hit by pitches in a game. Record's 10.
The record is 10. Rice hit 10 Washington hitters back in 1998. It was the College Station Regional. And now Greg Harmon's got to get this under control because Church was not happy after getting hit. He stared down Vega.
And I like what you said earlier, John. They're not throwing at them. They're not. They're trying to pitch inside sometimes, and other times they just get wild and it gets away from them. We asked Nick Mangione. He said that's what they do. They don't move. They stay in there. They take it. They like it. Give me a free pass if you're going to give me a free pass. And I don't see any reason on the Kentucky side why there should be any reason to be mad or upset. Now, it hurts sometimes, and that can get you going, but clearly Indiana's not doing it on purpose.
Waldschmidt swings at that first pitch, gives it a ride. Right center field, it's gone! Look at the Wildcat bats tonight. A two-run jack for Ryan Waldschmidt. His fifth of the season, and it is 16-4 Kentucky. And the Wildcats have set a record, the most postseason runs in a single game here in the NCAA tournament in Kentucky school history.
You're talking about a team that only had 46 home runs on the year. And again, that's compared to a Florida that has over 120. But man, they have blown up in a big way in this game. 4 home runs for the Kentucky Wildcats, 16 runs, 26 on the day.
Four home runs in this game by Kentucky. Big swing and a miss by Nolan McCarthy. He's got one of them. A 3-run home run in his first at bat in the second.
Seven runs in this inning. Everybody in Kentucky's lineup has scored at least once. 7 in a row in the seventh inning. 1 through 7 hitters have all scored. This is the 8-hole, Nolan McCarthy.
All right, good one too, Nolan.
16 runs tonight, setting a school record. Most runs in an NCAA tournament game. McCarthy down on strikes. Adrian Vega with the strikeout. Let's take another look at that home run by Waldschmidt.
Full extension on the outer part of the plate. Backspin, right center field, up in the air. And that ball's blasted. TCU pinned 20 on Arkansas today. This is the second biggest output of the day offensively.
It has turned into a party here in Lexington. Kentucky Proud Park loving what they are seeing. Kentucky needing a win to stay alive. And the offense has showed up 16-4 here in the seventh.
And now Grant Smith with that bad ankle is going to get a break.
Ryder Giles will pinch hit for Grant Smith, his first pinch hitting appearance of the season. So Kentucky scoring 16 runs, most in school history in a tournament game. For Indiana, this is the most runs they've given up in school history in an NCAA tournament game. And for Kentucky, that allows Grant Smith to get off that ankle, get some more treatment, and let his guys hang on with a 16-4 lead. Giles, fly ball, right field. Taylor giving chase, and it's out of play. Yeah, buddy, nicely done. Show off what you got.
Exciting moment in that kid's life.
As it should be, right?
Absolutely.
I mean, we all remember being little kids going to a baseball game, getting our a foul ball, giving people high fives in the section. I mean, that was the thrill of a lifetime.
Yeah, so the first one I ever got was in the parking lot. My dad always made us leave baseball games early to beat the traffic. And so we're walking out of Shreveport Captains Double-A game, and I'm walking in the parking lot, and here comes a baseball rattling off a few cars. That was my first foul ball. Still remember.
I love it. I love it. So many great things about the game of baseball, but getting the foul ball has got to be up near the top. 2-2 to Giles. Swings through that pitch for strike three. Back-to-back strikeouts for Vega.
And the second time in this game, the Kentucky Wildcats has batted around.
So Jackson Gray will step up for the second time here in this inning. It looks like we actually have a pinch hitter.
How about this? James McCoy.
Yeah.
Who threw it on the mound earlier today. Two-way player.
So McCoy will come into the game for the center fielder, Gray. And the freshman will pinch hit here in this top of the seventh with two outs. Kentucky with this huge 12-run lead will start to use their bench. To the count on McCoy. Strike three called. So Adrian Vega strikes out three in a row to get out of the seventh. But it was just bombs away in the seventh.
Seven runs in the seventh. How about Gillum with the home run? And then Waldschmidt. See you later. Kentucky with a big, big lead.
A seven spot for Indiana in the top of the seventh. They lead it 16-4, Kentucky over Indiana. And some defensive changes in the field for the Wildcats. Ryder Giles, who came to pinch hit for Grant Smith, he will stay in at short. McCarthy moves from right to center field. And James McCoy, who came in to pinch hit for Jackson Gray, he will go into the field and play in right. Indiana, Evan Goforth had a solo home run in the third. Also, new catcher for Kentucky, Chase Stanky, is now behind the dish. Ground ball up the middle, fielded by Petre. One down to start this bottom of the seventh.
Well, if you're Indiana, you've got to have a big regroup talk going into tomorrow with the season on the line. And I clearly think it's it always matters who you start, but it's equally, or it's more of a big deal now, especially for Indiana, to try to gain this momentum back as early as they can tomorrow, and it starts with their pitcher on the mound.
Yes, thanks.
Do you think it's an advantage for Indiana that they actually have a night off and get the chance to sleep this one and kind of flush it and forget about it?
Of course. Yeah, if they were, if you were to ask Kentucky whether they play tonight or tomorrow, they'd tell you 100%, let's just back-to-back, let's go. And for Indiana to take a deep breath, go home, regroup, come back tomorrow, is an advantage for them.
Any trips, any tips or tools you used to use in order to kind of get over something bad that may have happened if you were in a slump or something like that?
Well, I think you learn that as a baseball player, they always talk about baseball as being, a team sport played by a bunch of individuals. And I think you learn that as a hitter or as a defender or a pitcher, is that one day doesn't affect the next. And if it does, you're going to have a long, miserable time playing baseball. And learning to have a short memory is the first thing you learn in baseball. And so I don't think it'll be difficult for these guys. Jeff Mercer right there knows the game, clearly can help with that.
But nice pitch by Hagenow. He'll ring up Glasser.
Yeah, that was a nice inside corner for him. But for Jeff Mercer there, I think it is important that he regroups with these guys. And they're a young team, and they can benefit from his expertise and his knowledge of that as well. But that's basically what it'll tell them, is look, this game tonight does not affect what we do tomorrow. And get a good night's sleep, get some good rest with some confidence coming out tomorrow. We're going to throw whoever it is they're going to throw. We have all the confidence in the world in him. I assume Kentucky will counter with Tyler Bosma, the lefty. Kentucky has a few arms left that are pretty dominant. So, again, Indiana knows they're good. 43 wins on the year, and they've had a great season. And I know that they don't want it to end tomorrow. So they'll regroup. They'll come back strong, I'm sure.
And that's exactly what Jeff Mercer said to us when we had on the broadcast earlier. Bobby Whalen sends that one into the stands, foul. He said, this is the best on-the-job training for our young Hoosiers. We are ahead of schedule. We didn't even plan to be at this point, at this stage of the rebuilding process. This is one of those lumps you take along the way. A tough game. Kentucky has brought it to you, but your season's not over. Here's the 1-2 to Whalen. 2-2.
And part of what Jeff Mercer told us, too, is the patience part of this whole thing. He had to be, because they had to make a decision. Are we going to patch this thing together, or are we going to have the patience to put these talented kids and trust our recruiting process, throw them out there, and it's trial by fire. They finished ninth in the league last year. And he said, coming into this year, we knew there'd be an improvement, but not all the way up to second. Maryland dominated the league, but Indiana was the second-best team in the Big Ten. So they gained a lot.
Grounded to the left side. Giles at short. Good scoop at first by Gillum. A 1-2-3 seventh inning. Ryan Hagenow. Nicely done coming out of the bullpen for Kentucky in relief. And the Wildcats on top, 16-4. Got something special here at Kentucky. I mean, these guys just love playing together. And you can tell they play for each other. Even taking a pitch, getting hit by that many pitches, it's for their teammates. It doesn't feel good. But when you get to first base, it's for the team. John Schriff and Todd Walker on the call. Kentucky with a 16-4 lead here in the top of the eighth.
And it wins baseball games. Kentucky has more hit by pitches than just about anybody in the country. And it translates into wins.
2-3-4 coming to the plate for the Wildcats. Jace Felker rips it to the right side. Nice stop by Goforth. A sliding play in shallow right field. One down here in the top of the eighth.
That dude's acting like he's been out there all year. The home run earlier in this game, and that was a smooth play to his left.
So Chase Stanky, who came in to catch in the seventh, this will be his first at bat for Devin Burks. Stanky, the senior, batting just under 200 with one home run on the season. Pulls this one to the right side, it goes foul. All right, so I got another explanation on the Baby Shark. Not sure if this is true or not, but I had somebody reach out and said 2-0 count goes to Baby Shark. We know that, right? They play it. It's because they want Kentucky hitters to hunt for a fastball.
Is that what sharks do?
I mean, sharks hunt, right?
I don't know if there's too many baseballs in the ocean, though.
Popped up to center. Whalen call anybody off. We'll make the catch. Two down. What about McCovey Cove in San Francisco?
Yeah, there you go. I mean, you know, you could make it happen. I guess that's the best explanation we've had, though.
All right, we officially have a team already who has punched their ticket to the Super Regional round from the SEC, Tennessee. They will be moving on. They outlasted Clemson last night, and they get the win today. First team to advance to the Supers.
And how about being a two seed in that regional, in the Clemson regional, with Clemson being the number one seed, and being matched up with another bracket that the one seed lost as well? Auburn was a national seed with a chance to host. Now it looks like Tennessee will get a chance to host in Knoxville.
Pinch hitter, Patrick Herrera, sends this one to the right side, and it gets through the hole. A pinch hit, two out single for Patrick Herrera. How about valuable at-bats for guys off the bench for Kentucky? Getting a chance to get in a blowout, coming through with a single. Patrick Herrera, nicely done.
Yeah, that's the advantage you have. You can get arms in the game that you wouldn't have had otherwise, and hitters get some at-bats that you might need as you go down the stretch. That's the advantage of you know, scoring a lot of runs.
What a night for Hunter Gillum. A three-run home run his last time up in the seventh. Going for another one. But this one stays in the ballpark in center. Whalen with the catch for the third out. Kentucky in control, 16-4. We go to the bottom of the eighth. Let's update the national picture. National seeds to go down. We have our fourth. Number 9, Miami, has been eliminated. Devin Taylor at the plate lines this one to second. One pitch, one out. That's Herrera, who is newly inserted, makes the catch at second.
A lot of surprises in the bracket, John. Southern Miss has to be pinned twice to advance. There, that game comes on.
I apologize.
Tonight.
That was Morgan Colopy, who was at the plate there, who just lined out, pinch hitting for Taylor. Brock Tibbetts now at the plate. But Taylor, who has replaced the freshman of the year in the Big Ten, he drove in an RBI earlier. Now set a season record, 59 RBIs. That's a record for freshmen at Indiana. What a year for Devin Taylor. Good pitch by Hagenow. One ball, two strikes, the count on Brock Tibbetts. Strike three looking. NCAA Regionals coverage for all 16 sites continues tomorrow on ESPN Plus and the ESPN app. For more information, you can visit NCAA.com, the home for all 90 NCAA championships. You know, all the focus after this one's going to be about the bats for Kentucky putting up 16 runs, but Ryan Hagenow has done a very nice job coming out of the bullpen to silence Indiana.
And what we've talked about this whole tournament is not only the stuff, and of course, clearly you want to get hitters out, but the length and the longevity that you can give a team. Save arms for both teams, either side, because they're going to need it for tomorrow. And for Kentucky, who starting the day had to win three games to win this thing, Indiana was in position to only have to win one. It takes some depth of pitching, and the more innings you can give your team, the better. And Hagenow has done that.
Two balls, two strikes, the count on Carter Matheson. Pulls it to the right side. That's a fair ball underneath the diving glove of Gillum at first. Matheson will chug in to second and stop there. He's got a two-out double here in the bottom of the eighth for Matheson, his 15th double of the season.
Big night for Carter Matheson. Triple away from the cycle. Had the home run in the fourth, base hit in the sixth, and now a double here in the eighth. Hit the ball well tonight.
Josh Pine, first pitch in, strike one. Breaking ball, bends in there nicely, 0-2. Hagenow trying to pitch another scoreless inning in relief, the 0-2. Got him swinging for the strikeout. Two strikeouts in the inning for Hagenow. Kentucky 16-4. We go to the ninth. Let's take a look at our Capital One rewarding performance. Give it to Nolan McCarthy. And all four home runs from the Kentucky bats. McCarthy, it was Burks, Hunter Gillum, and Ryan Walshman. The last one, a two-run home run in the seventh. Reuben Church swings over the top of that pitch for strike one. Some defensive replacements. Colopy goes into right for Indiana. And Riley Langerman is behind the plate. He'll replace Peter Cerruto.
And that's the last piece of the puzzle, John, I think you wanted to see from Kentucky. The offense was good. We've talked about how good they were throughout the SEC schedule, how they put pressure on you when they're on the bases. They can obviously take a pitch, get hit by a pitch, and find ways to get on base. But the power was the thing they haven't really shown. But tonight, wow.
Church will fly out in foul territory to Tibbetts. One down this top of the ninth. And that was a question I asked right before the game, because the first few games, each team's got an ace or two, right? Like, pitching can dominate early on in the regionals. But now that we start to get into the bullpens, it seems like the hitters have the advantage and the bats are coming alive.
Yeah, and it's a lot of games in a short period of time, especially when you push to tomorrow for the deciding game. And you mentioned it in the open earlier today that this tournament becomes more offensive for that reason.
Walshman drive to center, and Whalen will track it down for the catch. Two down.
It's a nice play in center field for Whalen. And trying to turn one way or the other. And makes a great catch in center field. Still playing. I mean, down by 12, and the Indiana Hoosiers are still fighting.
Nolan McCarthy with two outs. At some point, pretty much everyone is on the other side of something like this. For Indiana, it's up to them. Now, how do you respond to this?
Well, we talked about it earlier. I mean, that man right there, Jeff Mercer, has to gather his group, make them understand that one day doesn't affect the next. And clearly they wanted to win this game, but you go into tomorrow with a chance to move on to a super regional. That's a big deal, not only for this year and for the program at Indiana, but for a player's life. You'll remember that forever. I mean, I'm 50 now, and I remember our regionals back in 1992 at LSU.
McCarthy pulls it to the left side, scooped up by Pine at third. A 1-2-3 ninth inning. Last chance for Indiana. Down by 12. Bottom of the ninth we go. We continue to update this national picture. Xavier with a 2-1 win over Vanderbilt. And Vanderbilt has now been eliminated. Clemson, Oklahoma State, Auburn, Miami, Vanderbilt, all regional hosts are now going home.
And it's Vanderbilt's coming off the SEC tournament win where they looked so good last week. And when we talk about teams getting hot, it can change pretty quickly. And keep in mind, the last two national champions, Ole Miss and Mississippi State, got beat up in the tournament, in the conference tournament. So they had more days to rest. And that becomes kind of a focus, really, because Vanderbilt clearly got worn out last week.
Can you remember a year in recent memory where this many national seeds have gone down early?
No, that's a lot. And you're talking about the top 16 teams in the country. And for five of them already to be out. And again, Auburn was playing well at the end of the season. I mean, they didn't win the tournament. They made a run. And at one point, they had won like nine of their last 10 or something like that. And get beat two straight in their own regional. Just hard to
Ryan
predict.
Ryan Hagenow, fourth strikeout tonight. Back-to-back strikeouts as Hunter Jesse goes down to start this bottom of the ninth. Riley Langerman, who went into catch for Peter Cerruto, will get his first plate appearance here in the ninth. Okay, Langerman. A base hit with one out. Guys off the bench getting an opportunity to shine on the national stage.
Yeah, I love it. And again, stuff you'll remember forever. And whether it's one base hit, whether you win, whether you lose, it's as we all know as adults, when you get into the real world, these are the best times of your life.
I wish I had known back when I was in college to enjoy it as much as possible.
Isn't that the truth?
I wanted to grow up as quick as I could.
Yeah, I mean, you're always looking forward to stuff, whether it's before you get your driver's license and then you get it and you realize it's not that big of a deal and then on and on and on. But that was the same way in college. And, I mean, I was playing for LSU. We won a national championship in 93, and it was fun, don't get me wrong. And I still remember moments in that time. But you're right. You're trying to move quickly into the next level. Like, am I going to get drafted? Am I going to get to play pro ball? And am I going to do all this stuff? And if I could go back now knowing what I know now, I would have done some things differently. But the main thing, like you mentioned, is enjoy the moment.
Evan Goforth slashes this one to right center field. That one's going to two-hop the wall. They're waving the runner. Langerman, the throw home. He will score. An RBI double for Evan Goforth. He's got a solo home run in the third. And Goforth, getting the start for Tyler Cerny, has delivered.
Yeah, what a day. The home run that bounces off Gray's glove back in the third over the fence, and now a double, RBI double for Goforth out of the nine hole. Not a lot of playing time this year, but he's a guy enjoying the moment other than the score.
Coming into the game, Evan Goforth had one hit. He's got a home run and an RBI double here in a Lexington regional final. Way to show up, Evan Goforth. Pulled to the right side by Glasser, fielded cleanly by Gillum. Steps on the bag, two down. I mean, think about this experience here in Lexington. People made a lot of deal about not having hotel rooms, but being able to stay in the dorms with your buddies to play baseball when a lot of other teams are home on the national stage. This is what being in college is all about. Bobby Whalen up the middle, and he will drive in another run. Goforth will score. Indiana picks up two runs here in the ninth.
Yeah, that's what I said about it. I mean, you know, you get a chance to be in, whether it's two in a dorm, even if it's a bunk bed, whatever they got in there. I mean, Those are the good times. It's not like you're going to be a 45-year-old man and bunk with another 45-year-old man, I guess, unless you're hunting in Louisiana, and they do that on purpose. But, you know, for me, again, you're with your boys. You're only going to be a teammate for a short period of time in baseball. Most of these guys won't go on to the next level. And it's just, I still remember the regional experiences we had in the early 90s down in Baton Rouge. And it's, again, so special to get this opportunity.
Morgan Colopy with his second at bat for coming in the game for Devin Taylor. Fans here at Kentucky Proud Park on their feet, looking for the final out. The 2-0 drops him there for a strike, 2-1. C-A. 75th pitch coming from Hagenow. Two outs, runner on at second. The 3-1. Colopy pulls it foul. And Indiana down to their final strike. Off the edge, ball four. The Hoosiers continue to fight here in the ninth. Runners on at first and second with two out. Got to bring up the first baseman, Brock Tibbetts.
I get that Hagenow is still pitching, and these numbers still count against you. But, you know, with this big of a lead, 10-run lead, I just think, especially with two outs, it's a situation where I grab the ball by the four seam and I throw it right down the middle. And that's every pitch, and let's get out of here.
Maybe that's what his catcher, Chase Stanky, just said to him.
Yeah, let's not dance around and give them free passes and make them feel like they're going to get back in this thing.
Tibbetts 1-for-4 today, doubled and scored in the sixth. Fastball misses wide, ball one. So while we've been playing here in Lexington, three teams have punched their tickets to the Super Regional round. Virginia, Texas, Tennessee, they will all move on here in this NCAA tournament. How about Texas? Because Texas could potentially face off against Texas Tech in a Super Regional.
That would be
Texas
electric.
A&M, excuse me, Texas A&M.
Yeah, A&M and Texas. And A&M has been playing well. Man, did they pitch it last week in the SEC tournament. Troy Wansing went 8, only gave up one hit. Lampkin behind him went 7, only gave up one hit. I mean, Texas A&M pitching came to life after having a 7 ERA half the year, not being able to throw a strike. They found it. Nate Yeske, the pitching coach, has done a fabulous job there for the Aggies, and that's why they're winning now. Baseball's all pitching.
So it looks like Kentucky's going to make a bunch of changes. Ryan Hagenow gets a standing ovation as the reliever will leave the game with two outs. A season high in pitches thrown, 78 from Ryan Hagenow. Great job for the Kentucky reliever. He leaves with a 10-run lead for the Wildcats.
He gave them what they wanted. Gave them some innings, ate up some innings for them, and Indiana still got 6 runs on the board. But if they messed around, Indiana could have crawled back in, and Hagenow kept them down.
All right, so while we have this pitching change, let's update that tickets punched graphic, because the 15th national seed, South Carolina, has now punched their ticket to the Super Regional round. Four teams have already advanced. As we fight here, Kentucky, Indiana, to see who comes out of this Lexington Regional.
What a great job Mark Kingston done in South Carolina. They lost Will Sanders, their number one starter. They lost their number two starter, and they've carried it through the year. You pluck two of your main guys out of that rotation, and you're going to struggle. South Carolina early was really, really good. I think they lost five of their last six series. This Kentucky team swept them toward the end there, but South Carolina can really swing the bats. At one point, they were leading the nation in home runs. Ethan Petrie, that freshman over there, can really bang it, and they've done well. South Carolina's got a well-rounded team.
We're in the middle of a pitching change here at Kentucky Proud Park. Ryder Giles is the new pitcher coming on for Kentucky. Trying to record the final out here in this Lexington Regional Final. This is Game 6. Kentucky needs this win to force a Game 7 tomorrow. Indiana needs a miraculous comeback to win it tonight and get to the Supers. As you see the numbers on Ryder Giles. This could be it. Right center field, McCarthy will make the catch to end it. A kiss of the baseball as Kentucky wins it. 16-6 over Indiana here in Game 6 of this Lexington Regional. And Kentucky will force a winner-take-all Game 7 tomorrow back here in Lexington.
What a performance by Kentucky. Backs against the wall, has to win. And they get a good start from Logan Martin, and Ryan Hagenow comes in and eats up some innings for him, and just an awesome, awesome deal for Kentucky, who forces game, a final game tomorrow. Some words being said.
Not sure what this is about, but this could lead to an interesting Game 7 tomorrow. Kentucky uses four home runs to get a 16-6 win, and it is time to update our bracket here in this Lexington Regional. With the win, Kentucky forces a winner-take-all Game 7 here in Lexington Regional. You win, you move on. You lose, you go home. Tomorrow, Todd, it's going to be fun.
Well, and then add that whatever was done right, said right there to the mix. Whatever, you know, it's hard to get under Nick Mangione's skin. He's such a nice guy, but it makes for a great drama-filled game tomorrow. Indiana got the best of them in the 1-0 game. Kentucky gets them back, and tomorrow it's for everything here in the Lexington Regional.
Our final here at Kentucky Proud Park. Kentucky 16, Indiana 6. For my partner Todd Walker, I'm John Schriffen. Winner take all tomorrow, Kentucky and Indiana for the Lexington Regional.